Tonight on Dispatches, inside Britain's biggest discount supermarket.
And this one is green as well. And it's broken. That's rotten.
The award-winning store with fruit and veg that shouldn't be on the shelves.
This mystery bag is 4 days old.
The code life of products should be transparent to the consumer that's buying it, and that means you've got to have a date you can understand.
Aldi says it puts customer service at the heart of everything. Really?
It is important to remember that you dictate the speed of the transaction, not the customer.
And we ask, who is paying the price for your bargain basket?
See the 15 minutes we arrived before our shift that we paid?
No. That is unlawful, requiring people effectively to work and not get paid for working.
Britain, we love a bargain, and our spending habits mean big business for the UK economy. Our shopping bills came to nearly £400 billion last year, and more than a third of that was in just one type of shop, a supermarket.
The early 90s, when we all seemingly fell head over heels in love with the supermarket. We all bought into the idea that we needed a one-stop shop for everything from a games console to a grapefruit, sugar, to a CD.
Fast forward 20 years, and like my old car, they've fallen out of fashion. They're not making as much money and closing stores. So what went wrong? Well, as we tightened our belts, they failed to lower their prices, and we started shopping around.
But one name more than any other has shaken up our grocery shop and rattled the once invincible supermarkets. Aldi.
Since it arrived in the Midlands in 1990, this German discounter has opened more than 600 shops, employs 28,000 people, and plans to almost double its stores in the next 5 years. So how have they done it?
Shoppers have begun to move towards Aldi because they offer a very good price, and so price has been one of their main points in the market. But they've also extended a view of quality to the British consumer as well. So that mixture of price and quality has given them incredible value in the British consumer's eyes.
Aldi has overtaken upmarket Waitrose as the UK's sixth biggest supermarket. It seems its cut-price products have made cheap the new chic. And they've won hundreds of awards too. It's cheese, it's wine, it's steak, and the creme de la creme. Last year, Aldi was again crowned which supermarket of the year?
Almost the same choice as Tesco and Asda, but a lot better value.
Once you get used to the brands, the food is just as good as the mainstream.
Everything about the Aldi I love. I used to do the Asda bus and sack them. I'm Aldi now.
But do happy customers mean happy staff? It's not scientific, but Aldi gets a higher percentage of poor online ratings on employer review sites than the big four supermarkets. Johan has worked for Aldi for the best part of the past 11 years, but recently left after being injured at work. He's taking Aldi to an employment tribunal.
The salary is brilliant, but people don't know what is behind it. What work do you have to do? You have to have four hands to do the job. It's because you always shorten staff. You're going to run the tills, you're going to run the delivery on the same time. You're going to have abuse from customers because you're not fast enough or you don't give them time to pack their stock. I'm absolutely shattered when I come back home. I feel like my body hurts.
Aldi insists its own employee survey scores higher than the industry benchmark for job satisfaction, and that Johan did not raise any grievances about the conditions while he was working for them. And it says it rewards staff well and has promised from next year to pay more than any other retailer. Yet, according to some workers we spoke to, what staff are expected to achieve for their hourly rate doesn't just impact on them, but on the quality of the food in our 5p bags. To find out more, we sent two reporters undercover as store assistants. Hayden will be in a branch in northwest England. Jamie has a job at an Aldi store in Scotland. And his first day gets off to a bad start. He finds he's expected to come in 15 minutes early, every day, unpaid.
See the 15 minutes we arrived before our shift?
Yeah.
Paid? No, so it's just unpaid, so you just have to come in.
Yeah, it's just so ready, basically.
Right,
so
okay.
you don't need to necessarily, if you don't want to, you don't have to start working, like, you know, going out of the shop for the railway. It's for you to have a walk around the shop to see if there's anything that's not on sale. Read these bulletins and get your till count between your till.
Okay.
No so that's what you have to have done for the time when you come in.
Okay, though.
Yeah.
15 minutes a day, 5 days a week. That would mean by the end of the year, you'd work more than a week for free. Every new starter is given an Aldi company handbook. It spells out staff must walk up and down the store before they start their shift and replace items missing from the shelves with stock from the warehouse. In the Northwest, our reporter was told his store had recently relaxed the 15-minute rule. But in Scotland, a manager was clear they had not.
It is a rule. It does say in your book.
Right.
It does say in your employee handbook.
I'm just asking because I'm just a bit confused.
I know there have been people saying, but really, so, I think if you came in just right on the door,
time,
you could really start people off.
Professor Dominic Regan specialises in employment law.
Well, first and foremost, what I saw there was an implicit threat about if you don't do this, then it's going to be held against you.
And if you are starting at quarter to the hour, should you be paid for that? Are there any circumstances whereby you shouldn't be paid for that?
None. Absolutely none whatsoever. That is unlawful, requiring people effectively to work and not get paid for working.
Aldi pays for its breaks, but admits that staff were, until April this year, asked to come into work 50 minutes before the start of their shift. They told dispatchers,
"The suggestion that our people undertake unpaid work is simply wrong. At the start of every shift, they log their arrival and are paid from this point. No work is expected to be completed before they have logged their attendance."
The Aldi work model is based on productivity. This is the amount of money a store makes divided by the staff hours needed to do it. Aldi says its operation is slimly staffed. The fewer the staff and the greater the takings, the better the productivity.
The Aldi model is a discount model, therefore it is very much about lean and efficient operations, and that includes the staff. They expect them to be multi-skilled and to multitask within the store, so they do different jobs onto a very efficient operating model. I think Aldi tend to do that rather more than many other retailers do.
And that's all spelt out in Aldi's workbook.
Have a flick through this, and it would seem the Aldi way is partially about staff getting a shift on, because there are time targets for unloading pallets, there are time targets for stacking shelves, and there are time targets for scanning items at the till. All of this while ensuring that goods are handled carefully, presumably to deliver the quality that Aldi promises its customers.
But our reporters find these tough time targets threaten Aldi's promise of high quality at a discount. In Scotland, Jamie is struggling to keep up on the shop floor without fear of damaging the products. Here, a senior member of staff tells him to throw bread rather than handle it with care.
Okay. I think I'm just trying to put things down too carefully, I think, maybe.
What happens if you can't break a loaf of bread?
Yeah. Okay.
So was that instruction to batter through it and chuck 'em a one-off? Not judging by what we find in the northwest of England. Back in Scotland, our reporter is again given advice to throw things onto the shelves.
Red, but see hangers, like, do you not think, like, when you're throwing it, do you not feel like...
I chuck it, like...
So I've not been chucking it, I've been putting it down, trying to...
Carefully, but I did nicely, you've got to put it in, you've got to do it, you've got to time it.
Things get broken, though.
Bill Grimsey has spent 45 years in retail. He's run some of Britain's biggest names, such as Iceland, Wix, and Focus DIY. What would he make of this?
It's not unusual in a supermarket environment for time targets to be set for certain activities. And what you've seen now is the pressure these staff come under to, in order to reach these productivity targets, manifests itself in the poor handling of products.
I mean, Aldi may say, you know, these things are achievable and we can point to staff members that do achieve that and we expect everybody to meet that top standard. That's the Aldi way.
Well, Usain Bolt can run 100 metres in under 10 seconds, but I can't. So I think that you need to get a measure in place that is achievable by normal working processes, by normal people.
Aldi told dispatchers.
Everyone at Aldi is encouraged to be productive and efficient to keep costs down for our customers. We set realistic goals for people to achieve based on current employee performance. They are regularly reviewed.
Aldi promises we're famous for the quality and value of our products. But in Scotland, on 12 out of the 20 days he was working, Jamie discovers squashed, damaged or mouldy goods still on sale. From bread that split to frozen bacon over 3 months out of date.
This went out of date on the 1st of April. This is like the third or fourth time that the customer's bought the cherries and there's mould on them. Oh. They're burst. And this one is green as well. And it's broken. That's rotten.
Yeah. Yet more mouldy cherries slipping through the net.
I don't think you need to be quite as thorough here, Jamie. I wouldn't.
Right.
And this store wasn't alone. Trading Standards in Bridgend found a large number of out-of-date products that were seized. Officers in Aylesbury Vale investigated out-of-date chicken and found issues with stock rotation. And in Tewkesbury, they found pet food alive with maggots. Aldi is clear that part of a store assistant's job is to rotate the products so that the oldest are sold first. But in the Northwest, a manager admits that even he doesn't always have time to check dates before restocking the shelves.
So it's funny, it's hard to rotate and still do it quickly. Yeah.
I don't like, when I work this produce now, this one today, I don't necessarily look at the date, but I'll just take one off and then put that one on.
Okay.
So I'm kind of hoping that's a different date.
But it not.
It might right not on. Be, yeah, yeah. That's the only way you're going to get caught out.
Yeah.
But
just it takes too much time to sort of look through every date.
If you keep looking at the dates, but the key is to get all that out as quick as.
Yeah. Aldi told dispatchers.
Our procedures for handling products are clearly set out, and we expect them to be followed by all employees. These are isolated incidents from just 4 out of over 600 stores. Aldi has an excellent track record in compliance with environmental health and trading standards regulations.
Whenever I shop, I always check the dates to make sure the stuff I pick up is fresh. In most supermarkets, it's not difficult to spot a best before date on your pre-packed fruit and veg. But try and find one on Aldi's packaging, well, that's another matter entirely. This shop might not excite the kids, but it certainly caught someone's eye. Now, on most of these products, it has a very clear best before date. Asda, 17th of October. Tesco, 18th of October. But the carrots that I've just bought from Aldi, well, for the life of me, I cannot see a best before date. There are some random numbers that mean nothing to me, but I reckon I can crack the carrot code.
First up, I call Aldi customer services. They confirm there is no best before date, but can't tell me what the code means. Then, after a bit of digging, I root out the truth. So, for all you Aldi shoppers, here's a quick lesson.
Here, 42, that's the week number, and 06, that's the day number, that is Saturday of last week.
So these carrots should have been off display 4 days ago.
And if I'd known that, I wouldn't have bought them. So, right now, I'm feeling a bit done.
And I bet I'm not the only one. Well, at least Elvis is happy. It's not a legal requirement to put a best before date on most fruit and veg. Yet those I bought from other supermarkets did have it. Trading standards say if it is peeled and cut, like the Aldi sweet corn I bought, then it should carry a best before date that the customer can easily understand. One of our undercover reporters, by now well-trained in the Aldi way, is on a shopping trip to four of their Bristol stores. In three of them, he immediately spots produce that should have been taken off display.
Three bags of peppers. These are 2 days. Is there an option? This mixed stew bag is 4 days past. These carrots are 5 days. A full bag within about 5 minutes of shopping. Full basket.
What's your reaction to that, Bill?
That is totally unacceptable. The code life of products should be transparent to the consumer that's buying it, and that means you've got to have a date you can understand.
Aldi told dispatchers.
Aldi is the third largest and fastest growing retailer of fruit and vegetables in Britain, which proves the popularity of our great quality fresh produce. Most of our fresh produce is put on the shelf and sold on the same day. We are not in breach of any government or regulatory guidance on food labelling. Aldi's approach to labelling is consistent with the practice used by other supermarkets.
Coming up, cutting corners on the shop floor, the staff who pay the price.
It's not my heart touching, it's not my mind. No one will be able to stand on there anymore.
And the very real risk to customers.
OK, so we've got four flower cages blocking the fire exit.
On dispatches, we're asking what's really behind the success of the supermarket of the year, Aldi.
Look at this, shoppers queuing almost around the block for yet another Aldi store opening. Is it any wonder that the German discounter has the traditional UK supermarkets on the run?
So what's the attraction?
Why do you shop at Aldi?
Cheap.
That's it in a word.
Cheap.
And good.
It's brilliant because it's basic veg and fruit and you can go and fill your larder with it. So if you want your five a day, you've got it cheap.
Bag of onions at 39p. And this, I read on Daily Mail, is supposed to have reviews on it,
right,
compared to a £300 face cream.
We're undercover in two stores, in the northwest of England and Scotland. Aldi describes its way of working as a dynamic business model, which puts our customers at the heart of everything we do. In the northwest, our reporter is taught that his till speed should be 1,200 items an hour. In this training video, he is told to discourage customers who offer the right change.
To speed up transactions after you have pre-counted change, decline attempts from the customer offering to give you change. It is important to remember that you dictate the speed of the transaction, not the customer.
Aldi's staff training makes clear that the till pace needs to be appropriate to the customer. Elderly shoppers, for example, may need more time.
But in Scotland, a manager offers our reporter his somewhat unconventional advice on how to meet till targets.
When I park, I'm not slowing down for the park. They have got rules that if they want to make themselves park, then they're going to have to.
Yeah.
If they say something, you say, well, as long as you say to them, I ask you to put the trolley first, this is a quicker way, it's how we do it. But unfortunately, I've got loads of stuff to do. So, park it back quicker.
What do you think of that? So pack your bags quicker.
Well, this is speaking to the environment that suggests that the time pressures and productivity measures are the sole thing that this company is operating under. And customer service is not in the frame, is it?
Aldi told dispatchers,
everything we do is focused on giving our customers the best possible service. We recognise that some customers will take longer to pack their groceries and pay than others. Our employees are trained to operate the checkout at an appropriate pace. The manager's comments do not represent the correct procedures all of our stores follow.
Aldi's time targets on the shop floor are one of the issues raised in a recent survey carried out by shop workers union Usdaw. The survey was small, but more than half of the respondents said pallet unloading times are unachievable and they regularly work unpaid overtime. Most alarming for the union was that three quarters replied that they have health and safety concerns.
Our survey results from Aldi employees was quite shocking. In the vast majority are raising the issues around hours of work, lack of hours, doing overtime and not being paid for it, called in at short notice, health and safety issues. The list just goes on and on. These are all issues which lead to a demoralisation of the staff. They also lead to health issues as well around stress and anxiety.
Both of our undercover reporters are instructed in health and safety, and they receive company guidelines, including the safe use of ladders when working at any height. But in store, this isn't what they find.
We were told at the start, if you use a ladder to get up there, 5 minutes later, the strainer was up on the shelf because she was in a rush to get finished.
And Jamie finds a senior member of staff climbing on the racking in the stockroom.
FYI, I'm not climbing on this. Your contract says you're not climbing on that, so I'm not actually climbing.
Right, so what are you doing then?
Holding him out there.
Then in the northwest, our reporter is on shift when an accident happens.
It was an accident.
Fellow store assistants are cleaning broken glass from a chest freezer after a colleague kneels on the lid to reach shelves and falls through.
What, you just had one foot up on it?
No, a knee.
A knee?
No, I won't be able to stand on that anymore.
I am sure Aldi will not condone what we've seen on these clips. I'm sure they will point to, they have policies and procedures that should prevent that happening. The question is, why is it happening?
In different parts of the UK, dispatchers has discovered safety issues that could also affect Aldi's customers. Reports of blocked fire exits in a number of stores. Our reporters too discover fire exits are often obstructed. In Scotland, a Facebook page for the store pictures a blocked fire exit, and our reporter regularly notifies the manager of the problem.
Five trolleys from the exit there.
In the northwest, from day one, it's the warehouse attached to the store that's a worry.
Okay, so we've got four flower cages blocking the fire exit. Trolleys in the way as well.
A member of management is all too aware of the problem. He explains that whilst the store has expanded, the warehouse hasn't.
Because it's small, you just need to kind of think where, hopefully where they should go.
And there's fire exits in there as well, aren't there? Yeah.
Fire exits in there. Yeah. At the minute, I've got hollow fire.
Is it?
Just purely stop.
which is nothing you can do about it. Nothing drastic happens.
He's not a bit like an eternal.
Doesn't sound like he's taking it very seriously.
Absolutely not. And this is, in my opinion, this is a matter of criminal law. I mean, obstructing fire exits, and I mean, there have been countless stories of tragedies because of these circumstances, and it puts people's lives at risk.
In a statement, Aldi said,
"We take health and safety extremely seriously, and all our employees receive comprehensive training. Aldi fully complies with all health and safety regulations. Usdaw has not provided us with any details of its survey. It was limited to a very small number of Aldi staff and cannot accurately represent the views of our 28,000 employees."
As Aldi opens new stores, some traditional supermarkets are shutting theirs. There seems no stopping Aldi's march into retail parks and high streets across Britain. Fewer staff, higher productivity. Other retailers will be watching enviously. Could the Aldi way become the only way?
Still to come tonight at 9, it's a 72-hour cat-and-mouse chase to whittle the group down to the final six in SAS Who Dares Wins. But next, Dave Fishwick and Kate Quilton wonder how prices are set in a new series, The Shopper's Guide to Saving Money.